thank you again, everyone, for joining us here as this part of this panel conversation. So, Jane, since we just showed your film, I wanted to start with you. It's been 10 years since 2008, the moment, the year that was sort of described as a renaissance in contemporary Taiwanese cinema in the film. But I thought it was interesting that you still found the need, or that there was a need, to expand a 30-minute documentary about Taiwanese cinema into a feature-length film, because you felt that there was really a lack of knowledge or a lack of awareness of what was going on in Taiwanese cinema today. Can you describe the nature of that gap? Why do you think that's happening, and what was sort of the motivation for expanding the documentary?
Okay, well, it's a very rare chance that we could talk about our own cinema, right? So just keep going on and on and on till we really ran out of funds. So it ends at this length. Otherwise, we probably will make it like a 10 whole series of, for every director. Mm-hmm. So, for example, in the almost the end, that we still keep thinking that, oh, we missed this one, we missed that one. So it's not a decision that we make, intentionally, but it's just that you have to finish it. It's so much fun making a documentary, but we have to finish it.
Robert Kane, how would you feel, since you're an expert in the Asian film market, how do you feel that Taiwanese cinema is now perceived in the marketplace? Is it perceived as a booming industry? Is it overlooked? How do you see it positioned in the marketplace?
Yeah, I think it's underappreciated. Mm-hmm. I'm someone who's lived in Taiwan. I have a nice connection with some of the folks here from the Taiwanese government. I know the culture well. And I realized that I don't even appreciate it as much or haven't really experienced enough of Taiwanese cinema as I should. Here in Hollywood, I think people certainly know Ang Lee. They may know the new Taiwanese cinema directors, a few of them. But I think most people have no idea what's going on, what power, what strength, what really great voices and talents there are. Mm-hmm. So thankfully, this series is playing a really important role. I think there's a lot more work to be done to mm-hmm. get the word out.
Yeah, hopefully. Mei-Chun, I wanted to ask you, as you were beginning to make your first fiction feature film, The Gangster's Daughter, what was your understanding of the place of Taiwan cinema in the marketplace, and what your expectations were for where your first feature film might end up, or where you hoped it might go? What were the possibilities as you saw them when you were making the film?
I'm not on the industry, so from my conversation with people, Europeans, of course, they know of Hou Hsiao-hsien and Cai Minliang, and their names are still very big in the art cinema. But other than that, Taiwanese cinema is almost invisible. And it's pretty much the case in Chinese language world too, unless you're like a super blockbuster. Mm-hmm. Historically, we're pretty good with Southeast Asian market. Mm-hmm. Their theaters, movie theaters, still show Taiwanese film and shown on their TV, so it's an easier sale there. But for my film, I think it's a little tough for the international marketplace because I spoke with some film distributors in Paris, for mm-hmm. example, and not only Taiwanese film, but they have the common comments about how hard it is mm-hmm. To sell Asian films these days, unless you're really edgy or it's a genre film.
Mm-hmm. I'll go back to Eugene soon. Eugene, so you're obviously based here. I know Chen Mei-Jun's based here as well as Robert, but from your perspective as a producer and as also a filmmaker yourself, how do you find Taiwanese films, in the States, in Los Angeles? Are they easy to come across? Are you able to find them in theaters, or is it?
Yeah. Not so easy, actually. I think that's precisely why, what Robert was saying. I think this is precisely why I think a series like this is invaluable, because the truth is, you would only really hear about Taiwanese films whenever there's a Hou Hsiao-hsien film that comes out, whenever there's a big film that wins a major international prize. So I think to this day, consistently, these are still people like An Li, Hou Xiaoshen, Cai Miang, and so on. And obviously, among the younger generation of directors, I think there are also more people that are rising and emerging on the scene. But otherwise, I mean, the movies that do even get distribution here in the States tend to be those either bigger films that you've heard about on the festival circuit or blockbuster type movies that very rarely get made in Taiwan. So Sadiq Bali was one example where it did get distribution by, I think it was picked up by Wago USA, and Assassin was the same thing. But otherwise, it really is very underappreciated. So even speaking for myself, I was born and raised in Taiwan, in Taipei, and I grew up there until I was 14, and that's at which point I moved here. So kind of like Xiaoya's son, Lee Chang, in the movie, I actually didn't really watch a whole lot of Taiwanese movies until I moved here. So it's kind of an interesting reverse journey where growing up in the 80s and 90s, I grew up watching Hollywood blockbusters. I knew about Hou Xiaoshen, I knew about Edward Yang, I knew about these directors, but you know, their films were considered esoteric, art house films, films that are not very interesting, not very entertaining, engaging. But for me, it was really through a process of self-discovery that I found these movies. And I found them enormously moving when I saw them as a teenager. So the point of this, I just want to make a very simple and quick point, is that even though it is still largely invisible, especially I think nowadays, the commercial cinema that's being produced in Taiwan, I think most people on the international stage don't know a lot about it. But I found a lot of people with similar backgrounds as mine, either 1.5 generation or first generation immigrants, or even people in across Asia, outside of Taiwan, people in Korea, in Southeast Asia, in Hong Kong, Cambodia, Thailand, so on. There are all kinds of filmmakers that have been deeply influenced by Taiwanese filmmakers. Mm-hmm. And it spans across generations. I know directors like Lee Chang-dong, for example, which the documentary refers to. Lee Chang-dong, the Korean director who did Secret Sunshine and Poetry. So I remember having a conversation with him, and he said that to him, a chief inspiration for his own filmmaking career, and this is a guy in his early 60s, he's a Korean filmmaker, he said that was actually watching The Boys from Feng Kui by Hou Xiaoshen, which is from 1983. And I've met younger filmmakers who are about my age, in their 30s, or some even their 20s, they just see a lot of, they feel like the kind of subject matters that are depicted in the New Taiwan Cinema, there's a strong resonance in terms of, I think, the nostalgia aspect of it, but also the way it deals with politics, political repression, which is a common experience across Asia. Right. So even though I think in Hollywood, in America, it's largely invisible, but I see it's clear that Taiwanese cinema over the last 30 years has had a tremendous influence on the filmmakers across the world, especially I think in Asia.
Robert Chi, I wanted to ask you, so obviously we can't talk about contemporary Taiwanese cinema, or it seems like we can't without talking about the New Taiwanese Cinema, which itself was a reaction, as we saw in the film, to this commercial cinema that existed in Taiwan in the 70s, 60s and 70s. We have a few points, we touch on a few of those histories in this series with The Vengeance of the Phoenix Sisters, which is a martial arts film from the 70s or late 60s. Moon Fascinating Bird Suite was one of those slow motion running lovers across the room kind of films, which is amazing, by the way. You should come and see it for sure. And of course, we have Super Citizen Co. Playing here as well. But my question is to you, how would you, we heard a little bit about it, but how would you define that turning point that the new Taiwanese cinema represented in terms of the commercial cinema of the 70s, but then how would you define how it's impacting the legacy of contemporary filmmakers now, overshadowing them as well as inspiring them?
Well, this is an interesting kind of question about rethinking the history of Taiwan cinema and trying to put things in the past in relationship to things that happened later in the present. I think actually a couple of things that we've heard already from the other panelists have begun to open up some of the important points about this kind of thought problem, especially what Eugene was just saying. We've heard several people, I think Robert and Chen Beizhi also mentioned the problem of visibility or invisibility of Taiwan films, especially here in the USA. And Eugene gave us a little bit more in addition to thinking about this visibility or invisibility, also told us a little bit about it from a very personal perspective. Mm-hmm. Of growing up in Taiwan, not watching or caring that much about Taiwan films, and then coming to the USA and discovering them or rediscovering them. That's actually not an unusual kind of circuit. I remember my own parents' generation, you know, my parents came from Taiwan in the 1960s, and they were part of that intellectual graduate student generation who really came of age politically in the early 1970s with all the kind of upheaval going on with world politics and the position of Taiwan in the 1970s. So it wasn't terribly unusual for people to be coming from Taiwan and only sort of discovering and thinking of themselves as Taiwanese until they came here or came out of Taiwan. But to say a little bit more directly about the place of New Taiwan Cinema in this, actually, this question of the visibility or invisibility or partial visibility of Taiwanese cinema, especially outside of Taiwan, we can actually think about this in kind of a reverse angle way, which is to ask visibility or invisibility in whose eyes. So I think one of the important things to think about is in terms of, say, the film industry and the state of production and so on, is to think about it in a larger systemic sort of fashion. The production is happening, and there are certain important issues and hurdles to be faced, but also you have to think about production for whom and who's actually going to end up seeing or wanting to see these films. So it's important to think about the Taiwanese cinema not just in terms of the production aspect, the context of the industry at the time, and especially in the early 1980s, and the kind of transformations and experimentations going on there with policy and so on, plus the innovations in content and style, but also in terms of what the Taiwanese cinema did for the audiences. And we know that in the 1980s, the first handful of films that we associate with the Taiwanese cinema in the 1980s actually did bring about quite a lot of new attention, renewed attention, even within Taiwan, precisely because they seem fresh, returning to everyday social realities and so on, a little bit less of the fancy genre films with this kind of escapist fantasies like the ones that you were just describing, the romantic melodramas and the swordplay films of the 70s and so on. But that wore off pretty quickly because, of course, people also had the choice to go see Hollywood action films and Hong Kong gangster films and so on at the same time. So actually, in the long run, looking back on it, one of the important issues to think about with the position of the Taiwanese cinema and its relationship and inspiration or burden to our position now, about 20 or 30 years later, is to think about how this short but very intense episode, the Taiwanese cinema of the 1980s, really foregrounded and highlighted the importance of thinking about not just sort of thinking about the audience in terms of their taste or what they want, but actually in terms of cultivating and encouraging people to look into cinema, to go to the cinema, to pay attention and so on. So this is sort of the other side of, say, being in film production, which is something, of course, is a little closer to what I do as an educator, is to actually encourage and cultivate the next generation of audiences who will be there to enjoy, to appreciate, and actually, hopefully in the end, to want to buy tickets to see Taiwanese films.
So we have this area, we have two areas, production and production, distribution, and exhibition. I'm wondering if we could turn to production, local production in Taiwan for a moment to talk about. Mei-Jun, what was it like finding the funding for your film? Where did it come from? What was the process like? We've heard a lot of stories about budgeting and resources in the documentary. What was your story like in making The Gangster's Daughter?
I think as Taiwanese filmmakers, we are lucky in a way that we got government funding. So usually for filmmakers, we have our script and we can apply for the script funding. And after the script is completed, we will apply for production funding. So once you have that first pot of gold, it's easier to go around to the private investors or bank to raise the rest of the money. And there are also local government who try to promote their tourist or culture or just simply promote their region. So there are funding there too.
You had mentioned that funding actually played a crucial role in finding the location for a film. For people
yes.
who weren't here on Friday night, I wonder if you could recount that story again. Of you were going to shoot the film in one island, but mm-hmm. then you ended up shifting it to another because of local funding, basically.
Yes.
Yeah. Could you, what was the, Kinmen Island, could you talk a little bit about your decision-making process? When you received that money, how did it then impact the rest of your thinking about the story in the film?
Okay. Yeah, so originally our script is part of the film will shoot in an island called Penghu, but unfortunately Penghu Island is they don't have any funding that year. Now I heard they have funding for films, so they opened the door. But Kinmen, on the other hand, where we end up shooting the film, is pretty wealthy because they have a wine industry there, and it's a government-owned wine industry. So they want, and historically, it's a war zone. It's like 20 miles from China and 400 miles from Taiwan, and it's a little bit isolated from Taiwan's point of view. So they feel kind of marginal, and they really want to promote their region, so they have this very generous film funding, film fund, and it wasn't very hard to apply. I don't know why people don't want to go that far, you know, from Taiwan. So we got the funding, and because it has that very special war culture, Penghu didn't have, so we have to revise the script, and we like the script better after it's revised because it has that war culture elements in it, and it's very special, and it's a gangster genre film, so it become kind of a metaphor for the gangster world, and also it just also when we try to develop the it's a coming of age of a girl, Xiao Wu. So she grew up in that island and sort of make her, it's also a metaphor of her personality. She's kind of very gentle and beautiful naturally, but when their like bullies come, confronted her, she will defend herself and become tough up.
Rob, I wanted to ask you, so there's this system of government funding in Taiwan. How does that compare to some of the other national cinemas in the region? And do you are you aware of an independent funding sources for films in Taiwan as a producer?
Well, to the first part of your question, yes, depending on the territory, there can be a lot of funding in some places. Singapore is very generous. You can get 50%, sometimes more, of your budget from government funding, and they also have tourism and the same kinds of things that Majorin was talking about, where there are localities that'll provide money to entice filmmakers to come. Mm-hmm. Korea also has terrific government programs and tax incentives and things like that. People's Republic of China has very little, really. You can apply, there are places you can get money, there are cultural funds, but it's kind of, I would say, comparatively haphazard. It's not organized in the same way. Mm-hmm. As it is, and Taiwan as well has a very strong incentive program. I think Majorin could probably answer the second part of your question much better than I could about local sources of funding.
Independent sources.
Yeah, I haven't made any films there yet.
Okay.
I'm really looking forward to doing that, but not yet.
Well, Jane or Majorin or Eugenia, are there independent sources of funding outside of government funding for film production? Is it?
Yeah, so I myself have not made a movie there yet, but I'm reasonably well connected in the industry, and to my knowledge, most of my friends who have made movies, I think roughly in the range of $1 or $2 million, I think part of it is government funding, and a lot of it is just private equity, wherever they can find it, really, because the environment is, I think, still, despite occasionally, you know, once in a while, you would have a movie like Zone Pro Side or Cape Number 7, it's still a pretty tough environment in terms of being able to sustain a career as a filmmaker, so people just grab money and plea and beg however they could, and it's really sustained by passion, Because as a filmmaker, chances are you are going to be struggling financially for a very long time before you see any kind of fruits. So I have a tremendous amount of admiration for my Taiwanese filmmaking colleagues, because it's really the sheer love of cinema, the sheer love of culture that drive them to do what they do. And that's my observation overall.
Well, we saw that, we heard the story about while he's shooting Sadiq Bale, he's shooting during the day and trying to raise money at night for the next day's shoot, which is a very difficult situation to be in.
Sounds familiar.
Yes, I'm sure that's very familiar. Jane, is that your experience?
I can add a little bit. I think in Taiwan, we are lucky, really, as like Mei-Jun said, that we always got some funding from the government, and more local governments are willing to offer the money. But when we try to, we got the seed money from Korea, and then we got a fund from our central government. Mm-hmm. And then we try to grab more money from different local governments. So as a producer, I submit all these proposals to everyone. And Taoyuan is the city that with the airport. So we said that it's very easy to, to insert a certain thing of like an airplane flying, right? It's very easy. You can, as a metaphor of everything. So we try to grab certain fund from Taoyuan, but it failed. They're like smarter than we expected. I think in Taiwan, I think most of the filmmakers really depends a lot, almost 50% of the fund from the government. Mm. And that really shape the idea of filmmaking, because you don't have that kind of economical burden. And also you don't know whether you have a chance to make your second, your another film. Mm. So in a way, every director is making it like the final one, your last one. And so you put everything you want to say to the audience into this frame. So all these more than 30 filmmakers interviewed by us, almost most of them, 90% of them are treating filmmaking as cultural event rather than, it's not part of industry, it's not a business. It's really cultural event. It's like creativities and your artwork rather than a product that put out in the market. So that is why if we feel that it's invisible in the market, it's not a surprise. Like Lin Zhengsheng, one of the director who got the best director in Berlinade, he was really very happy about the award. Then he started to think that, oh, how am I gonna release the film? So it's totally different, right? Usually when you start to shoot, you already got the plan and step by step. But in Taiwan, this is the regular cases.
I just want to say thank you so much for making your film. It was really essential. It made me cry a lot. I sympathize with what a lot of the filmmakers are going through there. It's not a glamorous job. It's really tough. I think everybody who's been involved in making movies can say that. But so important and really instructive about what's going on in the scene in Taiwan.
Well, Eugene, we're gonna.
I was just gonna say very quickly, because I think there's so much idealism, I think, in the industry among the filmmakers. And what's also nice about there being the government support is that I think it allows the filmmakers, like Lin Zhengsheng, for example, people like him, and a lot of my friends who work and make movies there, I think allows them to be more daring and audacious in their choices as filmmakers in terms of the subject matter, in terms of the aesthetics, the styles. Because obviously everyone would like their films to be profitable. That's just a given. People like to be able to make a living. But I feel like compared to, for example, mainland China or South Korea than other countries in East Asia, there's, I think, maybe a higher degree of freedom among the filmmakers. That's just my personal observation. I have no data to really back this up. But at least in terms of the community I've been surrounded by, I feel like there's less economic and financial pressure in terms of people when people make decisions about their creative projects. And that, I feel like, has allowed all kinds of interesting films to emerge that maybe otherwise would have been buried in the marketplace.
Well, but as Mei-Jun said on opening night, the film doesn't really exist until somebody sees it. I mean, and so there is this exhibition side of it. We know all the filmmakers want to have people see their films. Even if it's a struggle to get them to produce, then they want to have some people see that. But we're still talking about this kind of absence of Taiwanese cinema in the international marketplace. What are some strategies that we could talk about for how to change that, to broaden the audience for Taiwanese films? I think what we saw, I mean, Robert and I saw, I mean, dozens and dozens of films in putting together this program. So there were some films we wanted that couldn't get because they were going to this festival or that festival. So I am sort of newly aware of a great, a large number of films that I think are really fantastic coming out of Taiwan. But so what's the strategy for getting them seen? There's events like this that we're doing here in Los Angeles. There's film festivals around the world. Film festivals seem to be focused more on maybe the art house cinema or a particular idea of art house cinema that changes from year to year. But let's talk about strategies for getting these films seen outside of Taiwan. Robert, do you have some comments on that?
Yes, I do. And I'll say something that may not fully please you. You know, theatrical is a very important approach to getting films. I think most of us who make movies have that as our goal. We want it to be seen the way a lot of us feel it should be seen, inside of a theater with an audience watching it as a collective experience. However, we're really blessed with some major opportunities now in that there are big companies in Asia, here in the US and other places, online companies. Netflix is a very hungry consumer of local language production. They've got whole staffs of people who are focused on that. In fact, I mentioned I've been doing some work with the Taiwan Academy, and we visited them. They're sending one of their executives over to Taiwan to see what they can do to spark more production, more things that Netflix would fund and exhibit online. And I don't know if anybody's familiar with a company called Viki.com, which is based up in San Francisco, but that's really a type of Netflix strictly focused on Asian content. They've got over 100 episodes of Taiwanese TV, some movies. They've got a community that does the subtitling, their viewers who pitch in. So that is, I think, a really vital way of getting films shown and remunerated. Mm-hmm. There's real money in that.
Mei-Jun, forgive me for not knowing, but does Gangster's Daughter have a distributor, North American distributor, or a U.S. distributor yet? Or where are you, what's your strategy for getting the film out to audiences?
We have an agent, and there's American Film Market coming up, so we haven't have a distributor yet in Northern America, but I think hopefully in November we will find one mm-hmm. in the market.
Are you hoping for a theatrical release or a theatrical release that leads into streaming? And do you have a strategy for where, what you have a vision or a strategy for where you'd like to see the film go with the rest of its life?
Well, as a filmmaker, of course, my dream is for the audience to see the film on the big screen with a great audience together. But nowadays, especially for the young audience, it's very hard for them to get into the theater. So I think there's a very special distribution in America now because there are so the Chinese community are big and they're getting more. So there will be like individual theaters in different spot of Chinese community, and they just show the Chinese language movies. So I think that might be a nice way to go. Mm-hmm. And for like a general release, it will cost a lot more mm-hmm. probably than my whole film's budget to mm-hmm. market it. And it will be very hard to get the money back, I think. So we probably will skip that. Right. And then there's the streaming vehicle. So that will probably be it.
So your strategy is really focused on a specialty release then leading into, which would help promote a streaming release or a home video release or something like that. So
Yeah. And traditionally, we also start with the festival tours.
Right.
Yeah,
right.
To get it heard.
Mm-hmm. Jane, as a festival programmer yourself, what role can festivals play in helping to promote Taiwanese cinema both for audiences and possible sales marketing?
Yeah, I think the even the new Taiwan cinema has been recognized through film festivals, not through market policies. Right. So we really appreciate and really want to take advantage of all these film festivals. So like this one is, it was born because of a film festival too. And yes, we do appreciate that all these established film festivals, the programming, and all these reviews really help the professional audience to know, to appreciate all these works. So to me, I really feel that in the very near future, I don't think the character of the Taiwanese cinema will change a lot. Mm-hmm. It still be very cultural activities. Right. So I feel that yes, we could do more on the market side, but through film festivals is still the way. So a couple of things I regret a little bit that we could really make it a longer documentaries, such as some of the people that are too busy to be interviewed. Mm-hmm. We are happy we have Lin Qiong, the composer. It's been interviewed, and he speaks in a very funny way, and that's his feelings. And actually, nowadays, Lin Qiong is not just work for Taiwan projects. He's working all around, all over the world, actually, mostly Asian countries. So he's well recognized. If we, through such kind of figure, and people were curious about what, films that he made, what he helped, he composed, then certain people can be introduced, certain works can be introduced. Mm-hmm. I think that's the way. So Lin Qiong is the one we interviewed, and we missed Chen Bowen, your editor. Yeah, he edited for Edward Young. He edited for all these martial art films in 70s. That's his own training. And now he is editing for documentaries, even this one, and so many films and for newcomers' works. So he's the kind of person that we should interview, but he's so busy. And like Du Duzhi, he is the sound man for everyone, for Wang Kawei, for Hou Xiaoxian, for Edward Young, for almost everyone. Mm-hmm. Or Mark Lee, the cinematographer. He's now working really all over in Hollywood also. Right. And independent Asian friends to the Hollywood projects. So if we could focus on these already well-established film people, and through them we probably could introduce more. Yeah, so I think that is the way. And also there are two figures in this film. I think they are quite promising, and now it's like a racing in the international cinema world. One is Midi Z, of course, that tonight everybody's going to see. He's everybody.
You are all going to see Midi Z tonight.
That's an order.
Yeah, he's very well recognized, right. And he's award-winning. No, the way is just like Hou Xiaoxian and Edward Young before. Got awards and been recognized and appreciated. So he's the one. Another one is Song Meng Hong, who is the director of yesterday's Godspeed.
Godspeed, yeah.
He himself also is the producer. He was producing very similar films of his style. So he's got a collection of the, film noir and or like black comedies. And I think he's the kind of person that who can be, introduced with a more, bigger scale, and that the audience to know him better.
Well, one of the things that does come up in the documentary is as a sort of natural export market for Taiwanese films is mainland China. And there's some controversial stories that come up, but there's also some very successful stories that occur. What place does the mainland China have in or could have in the exhibition of Taiwanese cinema, and is that a market that it's worth making the compromises that might be required? Yeah.
Well, I can speak to that a little bit. And this is coming as someone, let me just say, very crassly commercial point of view, which is huge market, lots
like
of
commercial
money.
Too?
And also a real underserved demand for good films. You know, if you've seen Chinese movies, the ones that are doing really well tend to be, I don't like to use the word quality. And from my perspective, the way I look at quality, I think they're really bad movies. But part of, they do fulfill a need in the audience. Like, for instance, this movie, Wolf Warrior 2, which has done now almost $900 million in box office in China, taps into the patriotism, kind of even xenophobia, and it was very much supported by the Chinese government. And I say, okay, $900 million, well, maybe I can, you know, prostitute myself a little bit if I can get a piece of that. Now, that's, of course, leaving aside all the really important political issues, the identity issues that we saw in the documentary, right. and also the question of how much are you really willing to sell yourself out. But you can't ignore that market. And I think Taiwan could do more to get more of its films in there. There's only a few a year that are being introduced into the Chinese market. They've tended, not all of them do well, but Black and White Episode, I think, $60 million, something like that. They have the potential, and because there are, Taiwan has what, 1.5% of the population of China, something like that. I think it has far more talented, experienced filmmakers, actors, writers than all of China does. So there's a need there. I think there's a huge opportunity. I'm sure there's a way to make that work better for Taiwan.
Well, it's always interesting because Hollywood, of course, is gone to great lengths to try and get into the Chinese market to expand its films there. I was even to the point where I saw one of the Transformers movies. I can't remember which one it won, but it felt like it ran 4 hours long because there was basically a Transformers movie set in America, and then the second half of the film was set in China. And that was, you know, they basically made two movies in one, and I thought that was, aha, I guess this is a really important market for Hollywood. Yeah,
absolutely.
Eugene?
Yeah, I was just going to say very quickly in terms of what Robert just said, because I think in terms of the talent pool, I think Taiwan really is quite extraordinary in terms of the level of creativity. I think maybe that has something to do with the political climate over the years, maybe just better exposure, I think, to world cinema perhaps, because most of the Taiwanese filmmakers these days, they are just incredibly well-versed, I think, in all kinds of, you know, all kinds of genres, medias, and so on. So in terms of their adaptability to different cinematic expressions, I think it's really wide-ranging. So my understanding with, again, just being around the industry in Taiwan is that because China is such a huge market, that's where a lot of the funding is, you know, people would like to eventually have a role, be able to participate in the market in some respect. There is an increasing desire, at least among the filmmakers I've encountered, that want to make movies in China, or at least make movies that are would be friendly to a Chinese market. So we've already seen several examples of that, like Lin Shuyu, for example. I mean, he did his second film, Starry Night, that was actually a Chinese-Taiwanese co-production. And movies like Our Times, which the documentary mentioned, it's a Taiwanese film, but it did extraordinarily well in China. So more and more, there are younger filmmakers, I think, who have this kind of versatility and adaptability, who are trying to make movies that can somehow appeal to both market. So I don't know if there's necessarily a key example that has emerged as sort of the definitive film in this kind of Taiwanese-Chinese co-production landscape, but it's something that's clearly happening right now.
Robert, do you have any thoughts on the relationship between or the Chinese marketplace and the Taiwanese marketplace and how and where they overlap or don't?
Yeah, well, it's as others, it's pretty much indispensable and unavoidable at this point. But one thing that's also very clear is that it's very, very unpredictable. Not just in terms of audience taste or which kind of film or which actual film will attract an audience commercially, but also in terms of things like actually getting the film exported there, cleared, if there happen to be, you know, censorship issues involved, et cetera. And a lot of that, of course, then gets reflected back and internalized at the point of production in Taiwan, and that's how we see in the short film that's referred to here, Unwritten Rules, which is from the omnibus 10 plus 10, a very kind of satirical look at that, of what to do when you're sort of faced with this location set that accidentally has this historical vestige of the ROC flag attached to it. So one of the things that I think the actual examples that we've heard about can teach us is the importance of the diversity of different kinds of films. And again, this is something that we can think of in this kind of systemic way that I suggested earlier, in that there is not one mass audience where everybody's basically the same, or you just export it to China and basically China is just one thing, but rather, of course, there's many different kinds of sub-audiences involved, so that certain genres will work really well, like these more recent kind of coming-of-age romantic comedies Our Times,
yeah.
And You Are the Apple of My Eye, that kind of genre, which has become quite popular, in terms of production in Taiwan recently. By extension, of course, looking a little bit further historically, we know that, you know, genres come and go, they rise and fall, so it's quite possible, as I think somebody mentioned in the documentary about zombie films, there's going to be a craze for zombie films or whatever. One interesting example that's related a little bit to these young people coming of age, high school kind of films, is that there's a burst of films, I think really following from Blue Gate Crossing, which we saw bits of here in the documentary. In Taiwan, there was a kind of burst of films with gay themes, mm-hmm. which sort of combined gay themes with coming of age, high school kids, etc., such that at one point I was in Shanghai, I guess about 10 years ago. There's a time when I used to go there a couple times a year and was going to the Shanghai Film Festival and meeting with my colleagues and you know, film studies professors and talking to their students a lot. And it seemed to me that at that time, about 10 years ago, there's a kind of popular imagination amongst young people in China that Taiwanese film meant gay films, but in a good way, some of them were actually being shown, or at least were becoming available through some sometimes illicit means, like pirate video, but were becoming very well known with particular niche audiences, namely intellectuals and cinephiles and so on. So that's a kind of a micro example of how the production decisions about the contents and the styles and the genre and so on just have to kind of match up with the projected sub-audience groups out there, but still there's a lot of hit or miss, as I said, a lot of it becomes unpredictable in the long run.
I mean, it's a little interesting how when you, as a programmer, you're going to festivals, you're seeing the films that are selected from various national cinemas can create a distorted picture of what's really happening, because you're only seeing the art house films or the particular films that the programmers at that festival are interested in as well. I want to go back to this question of co-productions as a possibility for expanding or broadening on Taiwanese production and exhibition. It's really interesting, What Time Is It There is taken from a Tsai Ming-liang film, which was a Taiwanese-French co-production. And Eugene, you mentioned that co-productions, China and Taiwan co-productions are starting to happen. Robert, is this a subject you can speak to? In your experience, what are the benefits and challenges of setting up international co-productions in the Asian market, and how might Taiwan benefit more from co-productions, do you think?
Well, there are pros and cons. Any time you enter into a project where government involvement is necessary, you add a whole layer of complexity to the process of getting the film funded, made, and distributed. On the other hand, there are a lot of benefits that can come with that. Financing, access to markets that you might not otherwise have. Probably the most successful co-production arrangement on the planet right now is Hong Kong, China, where because of the cultural affinities, because of the proximity, because many of the film talent are moving back and forth between both places anyway. Mm-hmm. They're making, I don't know, dozens and dozens. I once heard 70 a year or something like that, co-productions. I don't think there's that level of activity anywhere else. But Asia does have a lot of opportunities and treaties where films can be set up, and the governments have programs to help smooth the process as much as possible. With China, it's tough because the government tends to put its nose in every step of the way. But it's possible there too, and there have been, when I say China, I mean China and say Taiwan, for example. But there have been some real successes, and I think there's opportunity. It just takes a little more effort, or maybe a lot more effort, but it can really pay off.
Mei-Jun, you had spoke about government funding, but I don't think I followed up at that time. Were you pursuing independent funding or co-productions, or was there any possibility that that would be something you could pursue for The Gangster's Daughter?
No, I was pretty lucky. I get my funding in Taiwan and Southern California.
Okay.
So that was fine. I didn't have to go to China. But right now, of course, we try to sell the film to China. Mm-hmm. And there are a lot of taboos, like subject matters you couldn't touch in a film. But sometimes if that happens in China, it's a no. But if it's outside of China, it's okay. So in my film's case, it's the gangsters' culture. And since it's outside of China, the whole criminal activity is not in China, so it was okay. And then they just complain a little bit about the cursing, too much cursing world. So that's like aftermath. And I think, you know, it really depends on the films. Like Hou Hsiao-hsien said, you know, he made the assassin, it happened in the ancient times, so it's a lot of freedom, creative freedom. Ang Lee's Crouching Tiger, that's, you know, fantasy film. So it doesn't really have a lot of tattoos they need to worry about. So I think in filmmaker's point of view, if they give you the money to make the film you want to make, why not take it?
Right.
But if there's like contemporary subject matter, there will be a lot of, you know, unpredictable policy censorship changes in China you have to deal with. So a lot of Taiwanese filmmakers just chose not to deal with it and raise the money outside of China.
Oh, go ahead.
Yeah, I just want to add very quickly. So as someone who goes to a lot of film festivals to raise money and talk to different entities and, you know, government agencies and production companies around the world, I think there are a couple of key advantages that I think Taiwanese cinema has. I think one is that there is enormous respect, I think, for the legacy of Taiwan cinema around the world, especially in Europe. I think that's why, at least from the European side, there's generally a lot of, there's a great deal of willingness to support Taiwanese cinema. So I think it's not a coincidence that, you know, movie like The Assassin and Hou Hsiao-hsien's previous film, Flight of the Red Balloon, which is basically a French film. There's a lot of French money that comes to support Taiwanese film. So that's something that I think is just very common because of the legacy of Taiwan cinema. But another key advantage, I think, for maybe the younger generation, the newer Taiwanese films, is that in terms of pop culture, I think Taiwanese pop culture has had an enormous influence on China. Even young people in China today, I mean, people in their 20s, 30s, even beyond, I mean, people grew up listening to Taiwanese pop music. I mean, Mandel pop music, as we know it, that's a Taiwanese thing primarily. The legacy, again, of people like Edward Yang, Hou Hsiao-hsien, they're enormously well-respected figures among Chinese cinephiles and filmmakers. So I feel like the commonalities between the two places, I think both in terms of pop culture and the sheer respect for the legacy of Taiwan cinema, I think that's a key advantage, I think, for people who are now perhaps trying to break into that co-production space.
I want to turn back just for a moment to production, because Jane, something you had mentioned and something that came up in the film and is also connected to the legacy of New Taiwan cinema is the quality and the expertise of the film crews in Taiwan. And I thought it was very interesting that it seemed that so many of the behind the scenes, below the line artists that were working on the films got their start during the 80s, the New Taiwanese cinema. We're talking about cinematographers and composers and editors, but there were a couple of points in the documentary where particularly for visual effects, there isn't really an expertise in the visual effects area, or that they needed to build film sets, but the best set designers were in their 60s and 70s, and they were out in the middle of the jungle trying to build these sets. At the same time that there seems to be a, as the one screenwriter said, you know, I feel people are asking me, why did you send your son into filmmaking? It's guaranteed unemployment. So is all of the things we're talking about in terms of the struggle to make films and get them outside and shown to outside of Taiwan, or this focus on art and culture, cultural activities, is there another generation behind the scenes? Where are the editors coming from, the composers? Where are the new set designers coming from? Is that, because that's an essential part of any national cinema production. Where do you feel like there's that the next generation of behind the scenes or below the line artists is there and ready to come up to support an expanded Taiwanese cinema in the future?
You mean the younger generations?
Yeah, are they going? I mean, do you have the next generation? We've seen the next generation of directors in the documentary, but yes. What about the next generation of editors and composers and set designers and visual
yes,
effects
yes.
supervisors who are going to be really necessary for making
yes,
this work?
Yes, right. That's almost the end of our of this
yes,
documentary
right.
because we are trying to chasing them. Like
right.
One of the one Chen Weihao, who made two features this year and box office. Successfully within 1 year, so it's really like crazy. And we interviewed his producer. He said that, oh, genre film is always very expensive, but nowadays it could be very cheap. But the director, you know, explained to us and said that, no way, I always ask for more money. So it's not that I could make it cheap, but
right.
I have to. Yeah,
right.
But they're so smart, they could always deal with this, you know, the low budget. So. Like edit by yourself or whatever,
right.
So and do this special effects with your classmates or something,
right.
But you know in the ASEAN areas, a lot of huge big film festivals they always have workshops to really let people learning from each other, so they really always could find your
mm-hmm.
peers to work together to learn together. And then also that like Lin Chang or like Chen Bowen or Du Duzhi, all these people behind the scene, they are really experienced. They work a lot with masters, the Hou Xiaoxian
mm-hmm.
or Wang Gawei. But still, if you have any question, you just go straight to their office. You just show them. I don't know if Majin did this. We did that. That we just you know. Palm on the door, and we went in, and they always squeeze out some time
uh-huh.
to give you their opinions, because they started with a very humble, you know, way, that because of their supervisors hated all this new Taiwan cinema, you know, young kids,
right.
So let them have the chance to be the one to lead the team. So they really always feel it's. Not obligation, but they're happy to help in
mm-hmm.
any way. And so the young people, young generations, even though they do not feel that they need Chen Bowen or Du Duzhi, that kind of masters to hands in to work on their work, but it's very easily they, you know, step into their office or to the workshops or to some seminars, to lectures, and to learn, you know, in person, because Taiwan is very small. Everybody knows everybody.
Mm-hmm.
Taiwan is so small, and everybody's squeezing Taipei, so even closer. So it's so easy, you just, you know, tumbling into someone on the street. I think that kind of is becoming a tradition that when you are more experienced or you are have more resources, you share with everybody.
Mm-hmm.
So Hou Xiaoxian started this. In a way, he set up a very good example, right? So he's always giving opinions.
Mm-hmm.
So like Midi Z always claimed that, not claim, but he really did learn something from Hou Xiaoxian. And that's the tradition. So it's very difficult to say that the young generation, they just do their own way. You know, sometimes you live under the shadow, but also you are nourished
mm-hmm.
by by them in person, not just you know, as a metaphor. It's real thing. Oh, like Xiao Juzhen, the director of this documentary, when she started her first documentary, she finished shooting and she has no money for post-production. So she sent Hou Xiaoxian, he that she didn't know, sent him a rough cut. And then Hou Xiaoxian watched it and then replied and asking her that how much mm-hmm. is that. And so then he offered $20,000 American dollars for her to finish the post-production with Chen Bowen's help, that he didn't know her as a young lady. Mm-hmm. So that is the kind of tradition that make you feel that if you earn something or if you establish something, you have to feedback mm-hmm. to this industry or to this big community.
Yeah. If I may speak personally about that too, because what's been amazing to me personally as a filmmaker is the degree of generosity and accessibility on the part of Taiwanese filmmakers. Because even someone like me, I don't work in the Taiwanese film industry, that's not what I do, but whenever I do go back to Taiwan, I seek out these filmmakers, I ask for opinions, feedback on my work, they're always available. Hmm. Hou Xiaoxian, Hou Xiaoxian's crew, Lin Chang, Liao Ching Song, who's Hou Xiaoxian's longtime editor and producer, they are as generous as can be. And it's also not a coincidence that you know it took Hou Xiaoxian about 8 years to make another feature, because between Flight of the Red Balloon and The Assassin, he was spending a lot of his time promoting Taiwanese cinema and helping younger right. Taiwanese filmmakers. So over the years, he's lent his name as an executive producer to all kinds of projects. So I've had friends, documentarians, narrative filmmakers, who have benefited tremendously from their wisdom, from their experience, and sometimes from their very practical help and feedback. And that's, to me as an outsider, someone who doesn't do a whole lot there. I show up, I sometimes consult on projects and so on, but the wisdom they're willing to impart, the time they're willing to set aside is amazing to me.
Hey Judy, is that your experience? Do you feel encouraged at the depth of talent in the younger generation of below-the-line craftspeople? I mean, editors and cinematographers. I mean, is that your experience with the industry?
Yes, like they said, they're very generous, sharing their expertise and their connections. You know, for example, Chen Bowen, my editor. So toward the end of the editing, he's like, "Where are you going to do your mix?" And I said, "Well, I'm going to bring it back to America." And he said, "Well, that sounds like unnecessary. Let me introduce you to Du Duzi. He's a buddy of mine." Mm-hmm. So I was like, "Really?" And he said, "Yeah, he just, you know, he's, yeah, exactly, next block, let's right. go now." So we went, and so they're very happy to see each other. They used to share the same studio, and Du Duzi was like, "Oh yeah, Chen Bowen, he helped me a lot when I got fired from the Central Movie Picture, and you know, started my own studio. So, what can I help you?" And Chen Bowen just sit there, like shake his leg, and looking at Du Duzi. So Du Duzi was like, "Oh, okay, you know, I can do this very inexpensive for you, and it's a lifelong guarantee service, you know, because if you need to remix and all that." So it just like, you know, the deal was done that way. And Chen Bowen has an assistant who edited my film together with him. And Lin Chang also, you know, my composer, has a like a co-worker, like a much younger musician. They did the work together. And so they both insist the younger co-worker gets credit. And also make sure, you know, every time when the news is released, the second, you know, coworker, not only the masters, but the younger person has to be mentioned. Mm-hmm. And sometimes our marketing people forget to mention the person, the younger person. They will be very upset and call and like, "What's going on?" So yeah, it just shows that, you know, how careful and caring they are to sort of try to pass on their legacy and also train the newer generation. Timberland will drive like 5 hours, each way, every week to go teach at a class in the Southern Taiwan also. And then he will be like very upset about like, oh, the young people nowadays, you know, you want to teach them everything, but they don't want to learn. And every year I only get one good student. I was like, one is good. Please don't quit.
Well, we're going to turn it over to the audience for questions in a little bit, but I have one question, and I'm not quite sure how to phrase it, but it was something that, again, I came up, I was thinking about when I first saw the documentary, and then I'm thinking about it again today. And it's connected, I think, to that passion about mentorships and openness to other filmmakers in Taiwan by this generation of masters. But there's something that, and maybe I'll start with you, Robert, about this, and you can tell me if this question makes any sense at all or not. But Taiwanese filmmakers or Taiwanese cinema seems to be perhaps the most self-conscious national cinema that I've seen. When I see documentaries about French cinema, Spanish cinema, you know, American films, I just don't see the kind of self-awareness about the national identity. I mean, it's there in French cinema because they're French, but you know, but I was really struck by the number of times and the number of filmmakers who were saying we're trying to find something about our country and who we are as a people, a very self-conscious national cinema in very positive, constructive ways, I think. Does that make sense? Is that something that you can describe?
I think so. Yeah, there's a number of reasons, both short term and long term, and both kind of practical issues within the industry and larger issues of politics and culture that would produce that kind of consciousness, or sometimes even kind of reflexivity or self-reflexivity in the films. The shorter-term issues, I guess, have to do with a lot with what some of the other panelists have already been speaking about, the very close personal master and apprentice kind of relationship between different film workers. The fact that, as Jane was saying, everybody knows everybody else. When you go to these festivals or to to the premieres of films in Taiwan, inevitably you'll see, you know, the sort of the luminaries of Taiwan cinema, especially the luminaries of the below-the-line workers, who, you know, sometimes you wouldn't know who they are because you never see them on camera, but they all know each other, and so you sort of overhear them all saying hello to each other before and after the screening. So there's that kind of dimension of being aware of making films each time that enter into this ongoing kind of tradition and ongoing field, the current state of the field of Taiwan cinema. In addition to which, of course, on screen, since Taiwan is fairly small, there's also kind of a finite, a large enough but finite set of actors and actresses. You know, for example, you know, Gao Jie, Jia Gao, is, you know, one of the two or three people that you immediately think of as a first choice if you're making a film with a gangster in it, right? Those are some of the more short-term and closer kind of reasons for that. The longer-term and kind of broader issues have to do with things like the continuing undefined or awkward position of Taiwan geopolitically in the world, especially, you know, in the shadow of China. And that, of course, has a very long history going back many decades, such that also has become baked into the DNA of Taiwanese cinema by this time, after, you know, decades of that, such that each time there is the thought, the ambition, and sometimes the anxiety of trying to say something or represent something meaningful, especially, as you said, in a positive way, about Taiwan and Taiwan cinema. But again, this is also something that then gets baked into the sensibilities and the consciousness of Taiwan cinema's viewers, right? For example, things like the actors and actresses who you see again and again, and you start recognizing them, and you realize that this little bit is kind of like that other scene in the other film, etc. Or you begin to appreciate some of the stylistic features of the music, or the cinematography, which you then can figure out because it's the same person each time, or you see that each film actually really is mixed by Du Duzhi or one of his apprentices, right? Basically every single film made in Taiwan in the last 20 years or so. So again, there's some short-term and long-term kind of reasons for that, but you're right to notice that it has become an important distinguishing feature of Taiwan filmmaking.
Mijun, did you feel when you were, one of the things that's so amazing about The Gangster's Daughter is its sense of place, and the history of all those places is communicated very effectively through the images. I mean, it's just like, it just really feels genuine and felt without being obvious. Did you have a sense of yourself as a Taiwanese filmmaker while you were making the film in the way that we heard some of the directors talk about in this documentary? And how did that influence your process or your identity as an artist, as an individual artist?
I think I'm a little different from the filmmakers in the film because I live in the States longer than the time spent in Taiwan. So I'm able to look at Taiwan in, you know, kind of a fresh eye or outsider's view. But I was born and raised there. So, you know, my Taiwan is close to my heart. And Gangster's Daughter is a 100% Taiwanese film, the whole crew and actors, and also with my anthropology and ethnographic film background, I have a lot of Taiwanese elements in this fiction film. And, you know, just some film critics said this is my homage to Taiwan. It's a love letter to Taiwan. Yeah, so I think, you know, we just can't help to like have this very strong sense of Taiwanese identity and to put it into the film because we have this big neighbor next to us, and even though it's always reminded, you know, and also about who we are. And in my film, there's this metaphor of Kinmen and Taiwan. You know, Kinmen is marginal, Taiwan is the mainstream, but the lead actress, Xiao Wu, she is like an island and she's isolated. And that's how I feel about being Taiwanese. And, you know, now we're like applying for the festival. Now it's electric application. And some festival, they just, you know, list Taiwan as like Taiwan province of China. And yeah, it's like, it's shocking. Yeah, and so in this kind of like situation and environment, you just have to feel very strong identity as a Taiwanese filmmaker.
Jane, your documentary obviously speaks a lot to this issue and seems also, you know, a product of that self-consciousness. Can you talk a little bit about that as a critic, programmer?
I think, you know, again, because that when our government started to fund cinema, no, filmmaking. It's because the film industry people convinced the government that cinema is culture. So cinema is not business, cinema is culture. And so it's in the roots that we believe, and it justified the government using the fund to, you know, to nourish the Taiwanese cinema. So that is one thing that to make it really cultural or make it really like social or politically conscious. So I think that is one of the reason why that you feel that in so many Taiwanese films that the self-consciousness or self-identity is so important. And also because it is our life. It is like every day you will face this this problem, that news that always reminds you that if you do not air out that we are Taiwanese, people will easily think of you as part of China. So that's quite scary. So so we would, you know, cry out really loud on this. However, some of this Taiwanese filmmakers could be recognized internationally, mostly because their language, their cinema language is quite universal. So that is why even the subjects is local, like Hou Xiaoxian's, like when he was a kid, right? Or all those kind of stories happened in Taiwan and talk about how they immigrated from China to Taiwan. Still, because of the art performances, and also because of the cinema language is so universal that people can recognize, can understand and appreciate it. So it really crosses over the you know, Taiwanese identities, but get into the art, the cinema art. So for the young generations also, many of them that many of the young filmmakers don't want to treat filmmaking that seriously, and also for them, China is an opportunity rather than just a taboo. So they try many ways to, you know, get through it with this light subjects, friends, or they go work there. So a lot of talents in China is quite amazing. Like for some time, I went to visit to do some research in China, in Beijing, basically, and we went to all these huge big studios or film production houses, and I'm very surprised that there's so many of my Taiwanese friends that I haven't seen. It's all there. So they are like contributing to the film industry in China also. Yeah, so it's not necessarily every one of them you know, focusing on self-identity, but it is always, I think in the future too, will be one of the very important issue in Taiwanese cinema.
Let's turn it over to the audience and see if we have any questions. We have microphones on either side, so if I call and you just wait for the microphone to come up. Does anyone have any questions for our audience? In the back. Let's run a microphone way up in the back.
Thank you so much. So the documentary talks about genre films versus art house films as a pretty big dilemma for Taiwanese filmmakers working right now, and the documentary talks about it in a way that's mutually exclusive from each other, but from I'm seeing it as, and there are some of the masters trying to bridge that gap. Like Assassin can be seen as a genre film with heavily art house, like very stylistic in a way. I'm just curious as to see the filmmakers in the panel, how they feel about this particular dilemma, the struggle between art house and commercial viable, more viable genre films, and how they feel about it, and as well as the producers and distributors, how they feel about it in terms of Taiwan cinema.
Okay, well, it's an excellent question, and I tend to think it's a false dichotomy. You know, you're right. There are you can do both. And you can, you know, to me, it's a way of saying, well, genre film, maybe it's not such an important statement, doesn't have social value or something, whereas an art house film does. And I don't really buy that. I just went to see a really terrific Indian film yesterday. If you know Amir Khan, the famous actor there, did a film with his wife called Secret Superstar, which is both a very light, entertaining, very funny, fluffy movie, and also a very serious exploration of domestic abuse and violence. And it pulls them both off really beautifully. It's hard to do, and they did it very deftly. But you know, that movie's gonna do very well, both as a commercial venture and also as a social, for its social value.
Major, I think The Gangster's Daughter crosses genres, but also it balances that kind of the more commercial gangster genre with a more, I think, character-driven art house kind of study. And you talked a little bit about adjusting for both in the editing process. Did you feel that? Did you feel a lot of pressure to make a commercial film that you had to sort of fight against, even though the funding was government funding, but with you know, did you feel that tension? And you resolved it, I think, beautifully. But can you talk a little bit about maybe that, how that played into it?
Yeah, that's probably the biggest challenge I had making a film, is try to balance the art house and the entertaining aspects. And that was actually our goal in the proposal when we applied for the government funding. And I think the government also want to encourage this type of filmmaking more in Taiwan. So yeah, in the past, they only give the funding to the art house. Yeah, and then once they start giving funding to the commercial entertainment film, they get a lot of criticism. But so now there's this balance thing. And yeah, so, you know, as a director, of course, you want to indulge your own artistic vision and make it like more artistic than a producer wants you to do. So my producer get involved a lot with me during the editing process, and we get into a lot of argument and fights. And our editor is very good at balancing art and entertainment also. So he helps a lot. And so we have a first cut, it's more artistic, and we're showing it around and get a lot of feedback, even though it's government funding, but I feel responsible to my investors. So then I make some adjustment, and at the end, this film turned out the way it is, and I'm very happy with it.
I think the most commercial film we have in the program is The Village of No Return, and that was a except the older one. So we have of the contemporary films, it's The Village of No Return, and that was a film, we don't have the filmmaker here, but that was a film, it's a martial arts comedy, it's a fantastic film, it's a lot of special effects, but it was basically made for a very specific market, an audience, the New Year's comedy film, that release period of time. And Robert, can you talk a little bit about how that went for it, or what, you know, that yeah. film's place in this
right.
series?
Right. This is The Village of No Return, or Jian Wang Cun, which is a Taiwanese, I guess a technically co-production between Taiwan and China, but primarily most of the work is on the Taiwan side. And it's made in the genre which is known as a New Year's comedy. New Year's here referring to the Lunar New Year, or the Chinese New Year. So for a few decades now, there has been this tradition, with a sort of marketing tradition, of releasing lighter kind of comedy films toward the end of, you know, December and into January for that festive holiday season. This one actually turned out, I guess it had kind of mixed results. I think it did, maybe some of the other panelists can say a little bit more about this too, but my understanding is that it did not go over
did
so
not
well,
do well
in China.
Yeah, commercially.
Yeah.
In China.
In China.
Oh,
in
both. Oh, both.
For sure in China didn't do well.
It's still a good film. You should come out and check
yeah.
it out.
So, but this makes for a very interesting a kind of problem or discussion, like what went wrong here in terms of the, was it release schedule? Was it promotion strategy? We also know that the director, Chen Yuxun, got, you know, sort of unwillingly entangled in this kind of social media battle in China over his supposed political beliefs, which had nothing to do with the film itself, right? Which may have actually, you know, contributed to the problems that it faced at the box office. Anybody want to add to that? I see Jane and Eugene nodding. Yeah.
Because the director Chen Yuxun was
right.
interviewed
right.
here,
right.
And
by the way, he was also in last night's film. I forgot to mention Godspeed. If you saw Godspeed last night, the doctor veterinarian that's played by Chen Yuxun, who's actually
yeah.
the director of Village of No Return.
He's
yeah.
a real funny guy, really a comedian actually. And he made, when we interview him, this Jian Wang Cun is not finished yet, so we talk about Zongpo Sai. It was quite successful, you know, in box office in Taiwan. And when they started to produce, they want it get into the Chinese market, which everything, you know, settled, except in the end, Lydia talked about that, the producer talked about that, that there is the national, the first national competition of something, and so the censor, no, bureau
cooking.
Said that you
it's
cannot
it's
have that.
It's just food, it's just cooking.
Well, so they get smart, cooking. You know, for the second try, this is a co-production, you know, this Jianwangchun is co-production of China and Taiwan, and so they want to release it almost at the same time, Taiwan and China, during the, you know, Chinese New Year. But it doesn't work. But I think it's just one lesson. I'm sure he will keep going, and and he will break through, because he's a smart guy and he's so funny. So they learn from the experience. So even though Li Die, the producer, and Chen Yuxun, this director, they are very Taiwanese and they are so influenced by the new Taiwan cinema, but still they are trying to find a new way. So that is the thing, they still embrace the value that we have, and they still worship this, you know, self-identity, but still they want to find something, you know, find a new road.
Mei-Jun, you mentioned something, I was wondering if anyone else might be able to comment, that the government funding sources are tending to want to see more commercial projects and fund more commercial projects. Is that something, Jane or Eugene or Rob, that you were aware of in terms of the trends of where government funding is going? Jane?
I know that maybe Ivy knows better, but but I know that years before that the money usually went to the art frames or the frames who which can win a lot of awards,
right.
You know, and but nowadays they want you have like half and half. You have to find capacity to fund half of the budget. Then you got. Another half of the fund from the government. That means that even our government, who love to have these cultural events, still feel that it's important to build up an industry.
Right.
Yeah. So, but step by step, because we have so many people and we have a lot of opinions.
Right.
So every year we discuss that and you know switch a little bit about the policy.
But it's less an explicit. We're only funding, or we're looking for more commercial films. But it's the formula of funding. So 50%. If you have to find 50% of it on your own, that the marketplace presumably would then determine a more commercial project. Okay, makes sense. Another question from the audience? Let's go right here in the middle. I'm gonna bring a mic over to you.
Hello, so first of all, I would like to thank Jane personally for making the film, because like myself, I'm not necessarily Taiwanese, but I've always been very passionate about the Taiwanese you know, cinema landscape, and it has been my passion to sort of work in the Taiwanese film industry. And I have sort of a straightforward two-part question. So myself is I'm freshly graduated from school, and I just want to know that if we you know, as a student, should we be thinking about going to Taiwan and working there, or should we be trying to, you know, maybe stay here and break into the sort of the Hollywood scene, and then, you know, try to break into the, you know, or try to contribute to the Taiwanese cinema scene? And the second part of the question was, should when we approach our work, should we be you know, taking a more localized approach, or should we be doing a more sort of globalized work to try to, you know, gain more audience and then try to, you know, sort of go for what we're dreaming to make for?
Well, I can, yeah, just respond. I mean, some of the questions you ask are more to your personal tastes and goals. I would just say get started wherever you can get some meaningful experience. Go someplace where you can be put to work actually making stuff. I once, very early in my career, I had an advisor tell me to make it in Hollywood, which was my goal, you have to do whatever it takes. And I said, wow, I mean, you mean within certain limits? And she said, do whatever it takes. And you can apply your own, you know, sort of conclusions to that. But I think she was right. you know. And I've had a career I'm proud of. I think there were times where I let my own fears or concerns, or maybe my ideas about what was the right way to go and the wrong way to go, really get in the way, as opposed to just making stuff. And so whether that, if you find opportunity here, that's great. If it's you find that there's more opportunity, more need for what you can do in Taiwan or somewhere else, then go do it.
Yeah, I would probably say the same thing. This is speaking again from my personal experience. I think I tend to be more of a romantic when it comes to answering this kind of question. I feel like you should just follow your passion. If it's the Taiwanese cinema landscape, if that's what interests you, then you should go there. If it's Hollywood films, then you should stay here. I've had friends who have done both. I've had friends who have come back to Taiwan because they feel like there's something they can meaningfully contribute to the Taiwanese film industry. They're American-born Taiwanese. And I've also had people who have gone there because for a very practical reason, they feel like here the industry is very competitive. They have a lot to contribute, but they don't have a way to do it. But in Taiwan, there's just a lot of support for younger filmmakers. So that's the decision. That's the thinking behind their decision. So it's very subjective. It depends on your personal preferences and passion. But speaking to your second question, local versus sort of a more, you know, broadly universal approach to filmmaking, I tend to be of the opinion that the more local, the more personal, specific it is, the more universal something becomes. I feel like the question really comes down to your means of expression, what kind of style, aesthetics, genre you adapt. Because this, I think, maybe goes back to, Paul, your questions about commerce versus art. Among the younger filmmakers that I worked with and am friends with, they all are deeply influenced, again, by the new Taiwan cinema and also by Hollywood commercial cinema. But they also have their own unique stories to tell. So they, people like, for example, the younger directors like Arvin Chen, who did Avoir Taipei and Will You Still Love Me Tomorrow, people like Tom Lin, who did Winds of September and Starry Night, Ho Ji Ran, I think is not a good example, who did One Day. So these are all younger filmmakers who have personal stories to tell, but because of their exposure to both Asian cinema and commercial cinema, and because of their own versatility and adaptability to different aesthetics and techniques and so on, I feel like they found an interesting niche where they're able to make very personal stories, but making them broadly kind of populist, but still retaining a sense of personal style. And I feel like that is a pretty fine line to walk, and I think they're still trying to perfect it, perhaps, but I feel like that's a pretty admirable attempt in trying to find a way to balance art versus commerce. So that'd be my answer, instant reaction to your questions.
This might get into a little bit of our curatorial conversation on November 2nd, but I always tend to think that the universal emerges from the local, and the more local and the more personal your film is, I think the more it's gonna speak to audiences outside of that, because we're all human beings and we all have very same struggles. And one of the beautiful things about that formula, or approaching it in that way, is with Gangster's Daughter, I mean, I think it's a universal film rooted in the local, and the more I learn about the locality, the very specific Taiwanese references that are in the film, the insects, for instance, the type of vegetation that, well, Stephen told me about it, he was here, the type of plant that she comes out of from the very beginning, which is connected to the local wine industry there.
Yeah, the sorghum.
Right, so the more I connected to the film because of its universal, because the universal is rooted in its local, but then there's even more layers of local to unearth that makes the film that much more richer. So the more local you can make it, I think the better, I feel, as a programmer, at least. So a preview of our conversation on November 2nd at the Taiwan Academy. Another question from the audience? Let's go right here.
Thank you. So my question is more for Jane. So thank you for making this documentary, because I feel like it was a very good recollection of the chronological events in Taiwan cinema. So I wanted to explore the alternative distribution. So we see Hollywood really focusing on TV shows nowadays. And in Taiwan, Tongling Shaonyu was such a one-off special event that we were able to break into the international market, so say. Is this something that directors in Taiwan, younger directors, are pushing into? Is it something that the government is encouraging in terms of funding or programs and workshops?
Oh, yeah, I think it's a trend that film makers go to TV drama. So not in the, in America too, right? And in Taiwan, like Zheng Youjie, the one make this, yeah, right. When he had this one not successful box office film, he would you know, dive into TV drama and get a lot of wins and then come back. So it's like a place to heal your wounds previously. But now it's becoming, you know, the TV drama is a very good access for filmmakers to do whatever they couldn't make for the cinema. So it's in Taiwan too, like this. I don't know if I'm replying your question. So it is just like this, and the government. We would have to ask our government representative. I don't know much about TV drama, that kind of funding. It's getting more and more, and it's in Taiwan. And also it's becoming, because many of the TV dramas really, really successful overseas. For example, the two very successful feature films, the She's the Apple in My Eyes, and also this Our Times. The two films are producers and actually directors are very very successful in TV drama before they get into the movie cinema, cinema business. So that means that their training, their commercial training in the TV industry is working well in the film industry. And that really, that's the part that we have no space to talk about. That means they don't have this kind of burden like all these filmmakers who study New Taiwan cinema. So they know nothing about Hou Xiaoxian or Cai Minliang. They don't know them. And they just really, really successfully to find all these idols, all these young movies, stars, all these actors, actresses, and managed to have them very successfully in China, too. Mm-hmm. So when they get into the film industry, it's very successful because there's no such kind of social issues or those kind of things. Only the shared memory, the collective memory of these young generations. So let me explain a little bit about TV drama is a very good way to let a lot of filmmakers to show their creativity.
Mm-hmm. Another question from the audience? Let's go right here.
Okay, I have a question about the market. This Gan's Daughter, how is Gan's Daughters in the box, the market in Taiwan? I like to know if Taiwan's domestic market strong enough to support our film industry. Of course, to bring our film into the international stage, it's just like to mingle with the culture that Taiwan be seen. But how about Taiwan? Domestic market, is that enough to support our film industry?
Well, that's a good question. We were focused on the global marketplace, but exactly what she asked. Is Taiwan's local film market or exhibition market for local films strong enough to sustain its own production?
No, it's not.
Okay.
Yeah, Taiwan's market is very small, and you know, since 89, it's an open market, so all the Hollywood films come in, and Taiwanese film just can't compete with those, you know, giant Hollywood films. So it's pretty average, you know, the kind of box office we get for like $200,000, you know, that's the average Taiwanese film. And there's a saying, like every year there are two blockbuster Taiwanese film. One is like a lottery, you don't know which one is that, and another one is a Zhuge Liang film. He's the, you know, in the documentary we saw, now he passed away, so maybe there's only one film every year. So, yeah, and so it's really hard for Taiwanese filmmaker now, and the foreign market is also kind of tough, and so it's really just get the Chinese money or keep it really, really small. So now the trend is not to spend too much in the budget and just keep it, you know, yeah, expected the kind of box office you will get.
So forgive me for not knowing, but so there's no quota system in the Taiwanese exhibition market? Like only so many Hollywood films are allowed, or no,
it's completely open. So for example, March is a very slow market time, and that's when we decided to put my film in the theater because we saw, oh, maybe there will be less, you know, strong Hollywood film. But every week we have like Logan, King Kong, right. Beauty and Beast, right. And you know, the Shelf. So, yeah, it's just that's where all the audience go to, and it's very hard to compete with that.
Yeah, it's hard for American independent films to compete with that in America as well. Well, is there any? Well, is there any chance that Taiwan might develop its own? I mean, that in the future it might become a more self-sustaining market? I mean, is anybody advocating necessarily for quotas on import, film imports, or is that something that local filmmakers would like to see happen, or is it just a matter of finding that right time and hoping luck strikes? Is that everyone sort of resigned themselves to that?
Yeah, I think we really kind of look into South Korean's model. You know, they treat film as a cultural thing, not a commodity. So they really protect and have the quota for their film. And if we can't go back to that because, you know, of the treaty and all that, we're sort of hoping our government will have some kind of theaters, you know, it's only show Taiwanese film. Right. Yeah, because it's very hard for theater people to survive in Taiwan too. So if they show a Taiwanese film for 3 days, it's not working out, it's gone. Right. You know, it's really just cruel that way. And then it's all Hollywood films. Right. Yeah, but hopefully if there are some Taiwanese film house, it shows Taiwanese films all year long and not having this kind of commercial pressure, then there might be a chance.
Rob, do quotas work in other countries in your experience? Can you speak to something in terms of sustaining a local production?
Well, I would say they do. China has a very strict quota, and the government has worked to achieve a balance between movies from foreign films, especially Hollywood films, that have helped finance the building of lots of cinemas. They have more cinemas there than anywhere else. But also there are lots of protected periods, or at least several protected periods during the year when new Hollywood releases are not allowed. And in fact, the summer is longer. It's a couple of months stretch where they don't allow. And a lot of Chinese local films have flourished during those periods. And I, from the government's perspective, I understand that. I think that they're helping to create an environment where these local films can do really well. France has always had, you know, a lot of places in Europe have certain quotas. Mm-hmm. And really it's Hollywood that's the big monster that threatens these places. Yeah. There's so much resources, so much government lobbying, so much arm twisting of other foreign countries to get our films into those, American films into those places, that it can squeeze the life out of a local cinema. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it has been effective, I would say, absolutely.
Yeah, I feel like it's not a coincidence, like places like China, mainland China, and South Korea, where they do have a quota system, these are among the very few countries where the local films can regularly compete and sometimes even succeed beyond what Hollywood films are performing in the local markets. My wife actually happens to be very active in the South Korean film market, and that's been her consistent experience. I think the government support, the quota system, has really allowed South Korean cinema to thrive in a way that, I mean, the last 15 years, 17 years has been like the golden age for South Korean cinema. And I think that quota system, that particular governmental support and implementation of this system, I think it's been directly responsible, I think, for that.
Jane, is that something that you might advocate for, quotas or some sort of a blackout period for Hollywood films?
I think it's too late to talk about this, at least in Taiwan cinema, market. Even now that Hou Hsiao-hsien, Edward Yang, and Cai Minyang are the most, how to say, best seller if we compare to books, because their films being, you know, sold over and over. Like this year is the 10th anniversary, passed away anniversary of Edward Yang. He died 10 years ago, and all his films been redistributed this year. So it's like he's still taking care of his own family, right? Even he passed away. So let's set up some example for the young directors. They know that if one market, you know, one Taiwanese market is not enough, well, if your work is that good enough for universal, you know, that language is for the world, in the long term, the money will come back. So that is the thing. But another thing is that in Taiwan, many of the documentaries get a lot of funds, really support themselves from the market. Mm-hmm. And we really enjoy watching documentaries in movie theaters rather than, yeah. So that is something different that's in many other countries too, but in Taiwan especially. Every year, the average box office, in comparison with the low budget, is really making much, much better than feature films still. So that means that our audience is still very interested in our own stories. Mm. Still is about self-identity. But for the market, I think it's not only in Taiwan, but all these ASEAN areas, every country have this kind of anxiety that you couldn't support yourself with your own market. So in a way, all these film festivals or all these film commissions, they are really trying to get connected. So I think that's a good trend in the pan-ASEAN area.
Other questions from the audience? Let's go right here, gentlemen, right here.
So yesterday, or maybe it was 2 days ago, we talked about how, you know, in the United States, we don't get to see a lot of Taiwanese commercial cinema, and how there's just not a market for Taiwanese commercial cinema outside of Taiwan, and that is a thing for most national cinemas. The things that flourish abroad are the more esoteric art house films, right? So I look at Cai Minyang, and more Americans know the name of Cai Minyang than they do of any other commercial Taiwanese film director, right? And I think about, I don't know how to say his name, but Apichatpong Virisitaku, right, the Thai filmmaker. And when he came here last year, he talked about how he made his films believing that he would never show inside of Thailand. And now we're talking about how Taiwanese cinema can't be sustained only in the Taiwanese market. And yet in the film we just watched, there's this mentality, all these filmmakers are talking about moving away from Hou Hsiao-hsien and away from Edward Yang and away from Cai Minyang, and how they want to make genre films a little bit more. There's a movement towards that so they can be more sustainable. But if the Taiwanese market can't be sustainable, and if it can't sustain the market, why is there this move towards genre filmmaking? I don't have access to the data, so I'm asking you. It seems to be the direction should be towards more personal, more art house films, because flourish in a global market, and that's the only way to make a rejuvenated Taiwanese cinema, right? But what am I missing?
No, it's actually more and more genre frames they can get even in Taiwan, like this Chen Wei House frame,
the Tag Along.
Yi Xiao Nü Hai.
Tag Along One and Number Two.
Yeah, it got sequel, right? Mm-hmm. And it's all make you know very very good box office, and you could sell overseas also. So and also this. Maybe not one, you know, a really huge big box office hit annually, but I think it's getting more and more, around five, could make profits from the market, and which is a healthy way that you always need to have to build up this market, not just imagine that in the long term that the money will come back only the market is still very important, and the market in Taiwan is not less small. Of course, it's much much smaller than China or the United States, but still, it's not a very small market. So, well, genre frame proved that it could survive. So, that is why the trend goes that way. So and it proved successful in many cases. Started from this 2008, the Cake Number 7, mm-hmm. It makes a big money. And in the same year, at least the three other new directors' frames got very successfully in the market. So it could be done. So those are examples that people, filmmakers want to follow too.
Because the unfortunate reality, too, I feel like is people like Tsai Ming-liang, Hou Hsiao-hsien, even though they're internationally known, I mean, we know them because of awards, because of the advocacy of film critics and festivals, most of their films don't do very well commercially in Taiwan or anywhere else for that matter. So even though we know about them commercially, they still have a lot of difficulty in terms of getting funding, in terms of sustaining their own careers in some cases. So I think that's another reason why there's very, maybe more a conscious trend, a conscious leaning towards making genre films is because you do want a market, you do want to be able to have a sustainable career and industry for that matter.
And there's the other category that sort of straddles the art house and genre, which is the auteur, which is really what drives international film festivals. They're looking for auteur-driven cinema, whether that film is a crime film or, you know, an example of slow cinema. You know, if the filmmaker is able to establish themselves with a strong voice, whether it's a genre filmmaker or art house filmmaker, it's that auteur-driven cinema that I think film festival programmers look for, critics respond to, and even if audiences aren't responding to that particular auteur, they still can establish a place in the international film festival world. I mean, in the same way that Tsai Ming-liang is an auteur, Quentin Tarantino's an auteur, and they both have, I mean, Quentin Tarantino obviously a very commercially successful filmmaker, but really got his known or became people, you know, in the film festival world saw his films first. The other thing that's really interesting is there's an explosion of genre-driven film festivals around the world as well. I mean, horror films, action films, Fantastic Fest is a pretty good example, and that model is starting to you know grow around the world, where you could be a genre filmmaker who survives on the film festival market in the same way an art house or an independent artist might, because there's now a festival network and a market network around that kind of genre filmmaking as well. Any other questions from the audience? Let's go in the back over here.
Thank you. So my question about like the Chinese hard censorship, we know that like Chinese is so hard to not only the Taiwanese film, but also to the Hollywood films, even harder to our own Chinese filmmakers. But like, I just want to know, like, if the Taiwanese have any censorship around the mainland China films, like if the mainland China film is about like the islands like the reunited or the reunifications, is it hard to get into the Taiwan markets?
We have no censorship whatsoever, mm-hmm. in Taiwan, but we. Our audience really do not like Chinese cinema, so that is the thing the market will decide. of course, we have only quota system for films from China.
Okay.
That is a little bit stupid. Maybe our government will change that, because every year we said it's so stupid. Mm-hmm. We want to see Stephen Chow's film, but you need to do the lottery. So every year you probably have 10 titles only, and you didn't get it, and we couldn't see it. But other bizarre frames get the chance to get into the market and totally failed, because, well, so at least for the Chinese frames in Taiwan, it's the audience who decide whether they like to see it or not the government.
So the situation with Chinese films being imported into Taiwan, it's a quota system, so it's not a content-based decision. It's any, right, okay.
Because you
right.
have to be fair.
Right, of course. Any other questions from the audience? Let's go right over here, gentleman in the red t-shirt.
Sorry about that. Most of the panelists said that I'm sorry if I'm paraphrasing correctly, but that the more local you get, the more universal it becomes. I was wondering if like a filmmaker made a film that's so parochial, it becomes hermetic, it becomes esoteric, it becomes like inaccessible. Does it still apply to will you still apply the same formula? Sorry about that.
Well, I mean, you still have to communicate. You still have to connect what you're doing with the audience or the audience you're trying to reach, and whether that's a film that's like Les Moulins, which we have here, which is a very experimental, I would almost say radically structured documentary about a particular moment in Taiwanese literary history. That film, even though I am not all that familiar or wasn't all that familiar with this particular moment in Taiwanese literary history in the 30s, 40s, that film, and it was very specific in terms of its subject matter, and again, previewing our curatorial conversation, Robert and I went back and forth about whether this film would be able to speak to an audience beyond Taiwan, and I felt it did, because I found a very strong connection with the film, both in learning this historical information, but even in its sort of radical structure. It used a lot of archival materials, the actual books, the actual periodicals, the photos from the period that really brought this moment alive, even though it is in itself a modernist art object and could be somewhat alienating to your typical viewer. But it still spoke to me, because on some level, the filmmaker was able to communicate. I mean, you still have to communicate, right? I mean, you still have to make things or build connections to your audience, yeah.
Yeah, because I think when I was answering the question earlier, in terms of my comments, I feel like there's sometimes among international producers, especially now, there's a lot of, I think, on the part of Hollywood, for example, to make movies in China, to partner with China, I think sometimes there's this, I think, mistaken assumption that you just can't have anything that's culturally specific. You have to make something that would speak to everyone. So anything that risks alienating the audience, anything that's maybe culturally just too esoteric, you want to get rid of it. You want to be able to speak to a global audience. And I feel like that's just not only is it not possible, but I feel like that fundamentally misses the point of doing any kind of cultural exchange or any kind of cultural co-production. Like what Paul was saying, my personal opinion is that, yes, you do want to speak and be accessible and so on, but you also want to be, I think, strategic, perhaps, is a way you want an audience, you want to be able to communicate with people. I'll leave it at that.
Yeah, I would say that there certainly are some limits or constraints about how local or how artsy or how universal or whatever, how personal the film can get in. I guess we would need to keep in mind that some of these terms that we're using right now in this discussion to try to categorize and understand the possibilities of Taiwanese filmmaking, words like art house and genre filmmaking, auteur, local, personal, universal, etc. These are all very fluid and flexible terms. There's oftentimes overlap, and a lot depends on the actual example. Does that actually feel very local and therefore inaccessible, or is local actually kind of a good thing, as I think a lot of the panelists agree? So, there a kind of counterexample of something that worked really well within Taiwan, maybe accidentally so, but I kind of think will not have much of opportunity for export, is a film that was a huge hit, kind of a cult hit, really, this past spring and summer, called Story of Taipei. It's Taipei Uyu, for those of you who are real local fans of Taiwanese cinema. This was a film that was written and directed by, I think, a veteran television writer and screenwriter and director or producer. So he has a very good ear for and very good imagination for commercially driven dramas. And the film is it's very campy, very much driven by the idea of deadpan humor. And it's a kind of ensemble picture with, it concerns a, there's one plot line that has to do with marital infidelity, there's another plot line that has to do with a corrupt government official, another plot line has to do with some petty thieves and burglars, and they all kind of get entangled with each other, and there's a kind of really amazing climactic meeting at this expensive villa of the corrupt council member. This film was released in Taiwan, I think limited theatrical release in the spring this year, and became through word of mouth, through incredible buzz among cinephiles and very highly intellectual and prestigious and respectable film critics and film scholars were praising this to high heaven. And so I was in Taipei. I actually was at the Taipei Film Festival, so that's late June, early July. And the film came back for a second run, very limited. It was playing in one theater in Nangang in Taipei, which, if you're familiar with the Taipei layout, it's a little bit off the beaten path. It was coming out again for a second run at this one theater, one screening per day for about a week or so. And so when I heard about it, friends had told me about this. I said, well, I got to go. It's one of these kind of, campy films. Go see a local lowbrow film that you'll never see on an awards ceremony. I rushed to the theater on Friday night, which is opening night for this second run. It was sold out. So I said, okay, how about tomorrow for Saturday night? She said, nope, sorry, sold out. I said, okay, well, I can come back on Sunday. Do you have a ticket for Sunday? Just one. And I said, nope, sold out. So I finally was able to get a ticket for Monday night. So I had to buy a ticket 3 days in advance and arrived there, and the place was full, completely full. It was, to be sure, a fairly small room in the multiplex, because, again, this was a second run for this film. But the intensity and enthusiasm of the audience was just off the charts. And hearing people talking about it afterwards, I realized that many of them were coming to see it the second and third and fourth time, and could recite all the jokes and point out all the sort of intentional errors in filmmaking, etc. So here's a film that was made. I learned from talking to the producer afterwards that as I said, the director and screenwriter, actually very very professional, very very veteran, experienced filmmaker there. So it was not the case that this was accidentally bad. It was, as I said, kind of campy and intentionally a little bit off kilter, and it worked perfectly for the local audiences. But again, I think this is a film that probably doesn't have much of a hope for any kind of international distribution, precisely because so much of the humor and parody there and self-parody there is stuff that's very locally specific.
Will you guys consider programming it at some point? I would love to see
we show that,
did.
Robert.
we actually did, because remember I talked, there was a Q&A afterwards, and I talked to the producer, and remember we did ask them for a screener, but they don't have English subtitles yet. Because I guess they haven't thought that far to.
That would be way too local for us to show without subtitles. But I'm sorry to keep going back to The Gangster's Daughter as an example of this. I mean, what I meant was, as an example, the very first shot, or the very first time we see the daughter, she emerges from a field on Kim and I, a field of yellow sort of flowers. I have no idea what those flowers are. Universally speaking, it was a beautiful way to introduce the character, because she's connected to a kind of wildness. She's connected to a kind of nature, and she has a kind of wild spirit throughout the whole film. So very visually, without saying a word, I know a lot about this specific character, and that's the universal. But when I learned later that this plant was specific to the industry and culture of that island, and that the insect she was playing with was specific to that island, it even deepens the meaning of that shot and that sequence in terms of the larger themes that the film is developing, not just the universal story of a father trying to connect with her estranged, or his estranged daughter and vice versa, but the internal local cultural differences between this section of Taiwan and that section of Taiwan. And the more you want to learn about the film, more about the film, because it's such an amazing film, and the more you learn about it, the deeper it gets in terms of the local nuances. But humor in comedy is probably the hardest, I've always heard, is the hardest thing to export, because humor can be very so specifically local, but also just idiomatic. And it's very hard, jokes get lost completely in English. If you translate it from Mandarin to English or Taiwanese to English, the local flavor of the joke is completely lost. So yes, there are some instances of locality that can be difficult to translate. I think we have time for one more question from the audience. Let's go to the back over here.
Thank you so much for sharing all your experiences. I have a question about the talents, because since Taiwan does not have that monetary value that it can like provide to all those like talents, for example, like directors, photographers, I think these people, like all the best people, they might be already booked by like China or Hong Kong or somewhere else. What incentives does like Taiwan, like the film market, can provide these like filmmakers to come to Taiwan and make these films, like to like attract these people instead of the like letting these people to go somewhere else? Because I believe these people might, their schedule might be always packed, but how do you attract them back?
Well, it's quite tough, of course, that they are very busy. Mm-hmm. But like Meijin's experience too, that all these very busy masters, they always have, you know, how to say, protege? Yeah, they're training new ones, young ones, to follow up. So it's like becoming a team rather than like just one person. So they always, if the project is interesting to them, they always make time. Maybe not, you know, hands in to do everything, but as a consultant, a real consultant, not just put the name on it. As I know all these great, you know, masters in different fields, they are all workaholic. They do whatever only, you know, for the work. They have no personal life. It's just work, you know, day and night. So it's anything that excites them is really, you know, interesting new projects or you know, young talents with potential, and they will be really excited and really enthusiastic, you know, get into. Did I answer your question?
Well, I guess I took one too many questions. Robert had to go. I went past our extended time, I guess. So I want to thank Robert Kane for being here and participating in the panel. But as a way of conclusion, maybe I could start with Jane and we'll work down the panel. Everyone could give us their closing thoughts on what their hope is for the future of Taiwan cinema. What direction? I'll start with you, Jane. Yeah. What directions do you think it is going in or should go in?
Of course, there is a bright future. But I say it is in a very good way, and I'm really positive, because I think China, in a way, is a threat, but also it's really a big opportunity. And all these, you know, how to say, all these filmmakers, they're like craftsmen. You need to always keep working, otherwise your hands will get cold. Mm-hmm. So a lot of work, you know, keep going and going, that's very important. And now is I think the opportunity is quite good. So I'm pretty sure that because of the quantity of the work, you know, getting bigger, mm-hmm. And the possibility of having professionals in different ways get into industry and make it a real industry, you know, out of the cultural activities, the real professional like distributors, producers, or you know the promotion teams to get involved with the creative team from the very beginning. That could be possible, and in that way, and with so many help, and like such kind of events and everything, well, I think to have a market is really possible.
Eugene, are you positive about the future for Taiwan?
I am. One of the recent developments that I think is noteworthy that we didn't touch on is, I mean, recent years there have been more and more international productions that have moved to Taiwan that have made films there. For example, I mean, we all know Scorsese's Silence, we know Luc Besson's Lucy, and of course Ang Lee's Life of Pi. I think these are really wonderful opportunities because these filmmakers and the studios behind them, they see either for reasons having to do with locations, the landscape of Taiwan, or the particular talent pool that Taiwan's able to offer, they've been able to bring these very big international productions to Taiwan, and that's allowed for, I think, a very positive kind of exchange between American international filmmakers and the local Taiwanese filmmakers, that they've been able to learn and get educated, even just in the process of collaboration, I think acquire a lot of very meaningful skills, technical skills specifically, from very experienced crew and cinematographers, producers, actors, sound people, and so on from Hollywood and from elsewhere. So I think that's a very positive development that I'm seeing. And also, given the versatility, I think the adaptability of the Taiwanese filmmakers, which I alluded to earlier, there's just no reason why there can't be a Taiwanese, to put it very broadly, like Spielberg or Scorsese, or we see, I mean, there's so many filmmakers in Hollywood and elsewhere in the world that are not confined to this dichotomy, art house, commercial. You know, no one thinks of Tarantino as a purely commercial filmmaker, even though he's incredibly successful. And in South Korea, for example, we have people like Bong Joon-ho, Park Chung-woo, Kim Ji-woon, these directors that all are critically acclaimed but make commercially successful films. And I think given the kind of talent pool that already exists in Taiwan and given the appetite that Taiwanese filmmakers have for Hollywood films, for world cinema, I just feel like it's a matter of time before someone like that emerges on the scene. So I'm very optimistic, personally.
Mei-Chun, positive about the future of Taiwan cinema?
Yes, I think there's, you know, all these very passionate directors that's, you know, always in Taiwan cinema. And the streaming service now, you know, like Amazon and Netflix, they couldn't go to China. They come to Taiwan and they're really looking into localize the, you know, the contents, the show. They're looking for talented filmmakers to work with them and create films and TV, so that's pretty exciting, even though it's a little dangerous because it might be a piece of chess they're using to get into a bigger global competition market like China. But for now, that's very good. Lots of opportunities. And also, of course, the freedom of creation is our most valuable thing in the whole Chinese language filmmaking world. And Chinese filmmakers are actually very envious about this. And I believe, you know, filmmakers, you have to create work from your heart. And that's what we have. And that's also a blessing.
Robert, are you feeling positive about the future of Taiwan?
Yeah, I'm guardedly optimistic. I think taking the long view, I would say that probably Taiwan cinema, if you're thinking in terms of the health, robustness, visibility, and economic potential of the Taiwan film industry, I think has kind of gone in waves. You know, there's cycles of up and down. Certainly the 80s was a high point in terms of the Taiwan New Cinema, but we also have to remember that there's other stuff going on besides the Taiwan New Cinema at the time. The 90s, we saw kind of a downturn, and the film that we just watched kind of begins with the bottoming out in the late 90s and early 2000s. And then it comes, you know, the standard story is that suddenly there's this rebirth around 2008, symbolized first and foremost by Cape Number 7, unfortunately, for Wei Dasheng, the director of Cape No. 7, his most recent film got kind of a lukewarm reception. This is the musical film, 52 Hertz I Love You, Ushar Hertz Waini, which actually had its Los Angeles premiere here up here at Melnitz in the James Bridges Theater just about a year ago, before actually it was released in Taiwan. And that screening, it was a one-time screening and it was completely full, it was packed. You know, tickets were gone days in advance. And yet, when it was released theatrically in Taiwan at the beginning of this year, as I said, it got kind of a lukewarm reception. So there are signs of trouble that we maybe haven't said much about so far in our discussion panel today. I agree with Eugene, as he mentions, the international productions that are actually coming to Taiwan to film Life of Pi, Lucy, and Silence. But there's also a downside to some of those examples. For example, the VFX industry that was, it was hoped that Life of Pi would somehow jumpstart the building of a visual effects industry locally in Taiwan, and it seems not to have happened. Nevertheless, I think, as I said, I'm guardedly optimistic, because at the same time we can point to certain other things which speak well of the long-term sustainability of the whole system of cinema. Again, not just production, but also distribution, exhibition, market, and of course, all importantly, the audience, individual people who are paying attention, and they want to see Taiwan cinema, they appreciate it, and they're willing to pay whatever money it is that's required to see it. So speaking in terms of the infrastructure of theaters, especially art house kinds of cinemas like the Guangdian Taipei network of small theaters, also the film festivals, of course, that Jane has worked on so hard over the years, Golden Horse and the documentary biennial, the Women Wake Waves, and the Taipei Film Festival, have become more and more of an event every year, such that, as I was saying earlier today, you know, when I used to start going to these, like Golden Horse and Taipei Film Festival some 10 or 15 years ago, basically I could just kind of get off the plane and go to the theater, buy a ticket, and walk in to whatever was playing. But nowadays, you really have to be there at the right moment when tickets, the advance tickets start going on sale, sometimes a month in advance, and certain screenings are just gone within an hour or two. So that kind of energy and excitement really speaks well of the idea that the audience is there, and it's continuing to be there. It will continue to generate itself so that there will be some kind of sustainability in economic terms for the films that do get made. Again, not enough to by itself to sustain it, but enough within Taiwan for it to do its part and inspire continuing production in all kinds of creative and innovative ways.
Well, for my part, I was very excited to start this project, what time is it there, the Taiwan Film Biennial, because we had seen so many things in the earlier, so many contemporary Taiwanese films in the 2014 series that we did, and of course, Ho Xiao Shen's The Assassin came out, and we had him here as part of a major retrospective. And I think that we actually, I mean, we'll talk more about why we chose the films that we chose for this year in our curatorial conversation at the Taiwan Academy on November 2nd, but I think that this is a, if I do say so myself, a very solid lineup of films that stands, could easily stand alongside any of the national cinemas that we've highlighted over the years here at the Archive. And of course, this is now, like I said, the inaugural year of a biennial survey of contemporary and Taiwanese cinema. So we will be back here 2 years from now to check in and see where things are going. But I just want to say thank you very much for joining us here on stage for our panel conversation. And thank you very much for coming. Get some dinner and come back for Midi Z, because those are two fantastic films. Thank you very much.